So strong distortions were observed for all nanoparticles when they were kept with these two ligands, with carboxy groups. But when these two smaller nanoparticles were kept with ammonia, with amino containing ligand, weaker distortions were observed compared to the bare nanoparticles. For all species studies, we observed that HOMAs are usually destabilized in cap nanoparticles compared with bare nanoparticles, and LUMAs are usually stabilized. Also, regarding optical properties, we observed redshift in optical absorption spectra for cadmium 4X4 capped nanoparticles, and blue shift in absorption spectra for cadmium 6X6 nanoparticles. Regarding optical properties, we studied only these two classes of nanoparticles because their ground states are singlets versus doublets or quartets for this and this nanoparticles when they are kept with sulfur-containing ligands. And now I would like to show you the structures of kept nanoparticles going from cadmium 3x3 to cadmium 9x9. So the top row is with SCH2CO2H ligand. Middle row is with SCH2CO2H ligand. And the bottom row is with SCH2CH2NH2 ligand. So what is really interesting is that nanoparticles which are kept with amino containing ligand prefer structures where rings of this kind are formed. That is, ligands prefer to be coordinated to nanoparticle centers, to the nanoparticle core, not only by their sulfur atoms, but also by their amino groups. So, and of course, for two other types of ligands, such structures sometimes are more stable than structures where all ligands make so-called open structures. And also, as we can see, sometimes structures with nanoparticle structures with these closed conformations or configurations of ligands have their cores almost undistorted compared with the bare nanoparticles. So this is a situation. These are structures of kept cadmium 4X4 nanoparticles. So again, SCH2CH2NH2 kept nanoparticles, we found that structures with ligands making closed rings are more stable than structures of these types. And these are structures of kept cadmium 6X6 nanoparticles. So as we can see, they become very significantly distorted compared to the bare nanoparticles with all three ligands used. And also what we can notice that ligands can make hydrogen bonds between each other. And also, they can make bridges between cadmium and tellurium centers, for instance. So there are numerous possibilities for ligands interaction with each other and with nanoparticle core. So it was quite complicated task to figure out which isomer is the most stable, because as we can imagine, the there could be a lot of different structures with close energies, where ligands could make different kind of bonds with each other and with nanoparticle core as well. So in here are structures of capped cadmium 9 X9 nanoparticles. So again, we can see that there are numerous cases where ligand S CH2 NH2 makes this kind of rings, and these rings also, of course, also appear when ligands with carboxyl groups are used. And as we can see, original structures of nanoparticle cores are very significantly distorted compared with the bare nanoparticle. And again, we can see numerous cases of hydrogen bond formation between ligands. And also there are bridges formed by the ligands between different nanoparticle centers and so on. Okay, so this is all for nanoparticle studies for now. Currently we perform studies on larger nanoparticles, cadmium-33, selenium-33 and cadmium-33, tellurium-33. Kept with different ligands, but this study is in the process and not published yet, so fortunately I cannot tell about it. Now I would like to tell, this is again acknowledgments to the co-authors and to financial support of this study. And now I would like to tell a bit about another site of my work at Duke University, studies of metalloporphyrins, exemplified by recent research on substituted nickel porphyrins. So this research was performed with undergraduate student as well as previous paper which I talked about. So in this study we tried to investigate effects of different substituents on electronic structures and planarity of nickel porphyrins. So first of all, I'd like to say a few words about metalloporphyrins and related compounds. Metalloporphyrins are ubiquitous chromophores in nature and also electron transfer agents. This leads to their numerous biological functions. As we can see, oxygen transport in hemoglobins, oxygen dioxygen storage in myoglobins, detoxification like in cytochrome P450, oxidative metabolism, like in cytochrome C oxidase, gas sensing, light energy collection and transport, solar energy to chemical energy conversion as in photosynthetic reaction centers, electron transfer in different cytochromes, and so on. And also they have numerous technological applications in catalysis, photodynamic therapy, electro-optics and non-linear optics, fabrication of different semiconductor devices and molecular electronics, in artificial photosynthesis, and as sensitizers for dye-synthesized solar cells. Also, they can be used in sensing devices and so on. Now, a bit about structures electronic structures and geometric structures of porphyrins and factors which could affect them, which could affect their planarity and electronic structure. So first factor to affect metalloporphyrins geometries and electronic properties could be sterically demanding or electron withdrawing or electron donating substituents in so-called mesopositions, red ones, or beta positions, blue ones. So, of course, as we can imagine, we can put a lot of different substituents in these positions. We can put both electron withdrawing and electron donating substituents of different types. or we can use bulky substituents. So we can play, we can, there is huge field for play in this aspect. Also, we can annulate benzene rings or naphthalene rings, for instance, in these positions in these positions of tetrapyrrole rings, and thus affect electronic and structural properties of metalloporphyrins as well. So second way could be change of oxidation and spin state of central atom. Of course, there is a huge field for play here as well. We can use any transition metal from the periodic table and some metals from main groups as well. We can use different axial ligands coordinated to the central atom to the metal center. Sorry. We can oxidize or reduce the whole porphyrin moiety. We can alterate its conjugation by oxidizing or reducing these nitrogens, for instance. We can add different ligands to these nitrogens. It's so-called nitrogen substitution. We can make cation radical or cation anion of the whole species. We can also strap the whole mica cycle across the ring using covalent linkage, so the whole structure would remind a basket with a handle. And also we can substitute these pyrrole nitrogens, either one or two or three or all four, with some other atoms, phosphorus atoms, for instance. So in our study, we investigated first of all effects of meso and beta substitution with these four types of four types of electron donating and electron accepting groups. A resonance-enabled acceptor, NO2, inductive electron acceptor, C-fluorine-3, inductive acceptors with electron donation ability through resonance as bromine, and inductive donors as CH3 groups. We also investigated solvent effects, water, benzene, and acetonitrile. And most important and most interesting was to study effects of replacement of pyrrole nitrogens with heavier congeners, phosphorus atoms. I should say that these kind of studies were mostly done before with different electron withdrawing and electron substituting groups. But so far, these kind of studies never have been done theoretically, and some experimental studies were done where either one or two two pyrrole nitrogens were substituted by the phosphorus atoms. So for us in this study, the most interesting was investigate this effect.